Good evening, everyone. I am Marc, and this is my talk. So, I guess I'm gonna talk about just a quick talk about solid. Has anyone heard of solid before? Any quick raise of hands? Solid ba tayo dyan? Solid. Low hanging fruit eh. So, basically I'm gonna just discuss each principle and a few examples of how they play out in Ruby. So, and then but before that I'm going to discuss why, and then also a few further readings or maybe exercises you could do after. So let's talk about why. When I came into my first programming job, and I was bombarded with a lot of acronyms and like don't repeat yourself or and this is one of the things that I didn't really get. And even today, although I do get the meaning, I can't be aware of them at all times, like in a particular, in any given code base, because the examples, they're pretty small, and when you're thrown into a real live application, it's not there's a gap, like you kind of need to have a bit of experience to experience a bit of pain in the like big classes or big methods that you can't really get around, I guess if you're here, you've all had written in applications before, right? Am I right? Quick raise of hands. Oh, yeah. Almost everyone, right? I mean, except if you're a marketer or whatever. I guess the common theme is in any given application, it will always change. So, and the thing with change is that it's hard to predict. Like I think a few months ago I was talking to someone, and he was complaining about feeling that his work is not it's not worth it, because, and the way he tells the story is that, okay, I implement a few features here and there, features 1, 2, and 3, and then client would say, oh, I don't want this, I want something else. And it's kind of pretty common. And his complaint was, maybe if the clients knew what they wanted, maybe I wouldn't feel as bad as removing my code and just implementing everything from scratch. The thing that this solves, that design solves, is that you don't have to throw everything away. Like every time you change behavior or a feature, you don't have to throw everything away, and you can reuse some of the ones you've written before. So think of it as Lego blocks. You're making little Lego blocks, and you're hoping that someday you can use that and you can plug other new Lego blocks that would make it behave in a slightly different way. So that's why we design in software. So I'm gonna just describe the first one, which is single responsibility principle. This one is probably the most general or like the overarching principle, because it's kind of simple. The definition, the name speaks for itself. Like, classes or functions should have, or modules should have one single responsibility. But how that plays out in a typical application is that it's hard to define what a certain class or function does. So an alternative would be, if a class has more than one reason to change, then it may have more than one responsibility. So that's why, here's a second bullet point there. So just an example. So I've taken one from an code example from a book. So basically, it describes some gear class, which is calculating some ratio and gear inches. So this is in the context of a bicycle. So just a quick read of attributes. You have a chain ring and a cog. That's what you would see in this picture. So you have cogs in the bicycle, and here's a chain ring. Although in our case, the class only has one cog. It's not that complicated yet. So it also has a rim and a tire. The rim and tire are measurements of the wheel, like the rim. I can't see it here. It's white. The rim and the metal part and the tire, the rubber part of the wheel. So that's what the rim and tire is for. There are the measurements and the diameter. And then for the chainring and cog, they're like the number of teeth. So it calculates for the ratio, and it also calculates for gear inches. Gear inches is something. Let's go first with the ratio. The ratio is, if you have a bigger chainring and a smaller cog, basically your bike will go faster, and vice versa. When the cog is bigger compared to the chain ring, your bike is slower. So that's why it's computing for that. There are a few heuristics that you can throw in any given class, and to identify if it's doing, to kind of check if it's doing one responsibility. Like, for example, you can pretend that it's a sentient being and ask it, oh, gear, Mr. Gear, do you have what's your ratio or what's your gear inches? So in this example, actually, you have a rim and a tire, and the gear doesn't have tire, so it's kind of so this method is kind of in a questionable. Maybe it has more than one responsibility. We can perhaps ask a question: what if I add a wooden wheel to it? Like, it doesn't have a tire, or it doesn't. It's not exactly the rim. It's like a wooden wheel would probably just be a wooden wheel. So what you could end up doing is, say, if you want to rip out rim and tires out of that class and put it in somewhere else. So here's what it could look like. you still have a gear class, and then you're just plugging in wheel into it, and then the wheel, whatever that wheel is, in this case, you only need to have it respond to the diameter. It doesn't have to have a tire or rim. So this is the wheel class, and also this could, what a wooden wheel could look like. I mean, maybe it just has a diameter. So you can actually check if this works. Can you see it? So I'm just putting the result of gear inches in here. What's next? Does anybody have questions? None? Let's proceed. Second one is open-close principle. Basically, any given entity should be open for extension and closed for modification. You try as hard as possible that every class modular function is a. You can slightly change its behavior without actually changing the code within it. So actually, we can just go back to our example earlier. Now we can, in the gear class, we can plug in any kind of wheel-ish that responds to a diameter message. So we could add a third wheel. We could add a third wheel. And anything that just responds to the diameter could be a circle. I mean, and it would just work. The gear class would still work, basically, without having to modify anything inside the gear class. So that's for open-closed principle. The third one, this one is the disk of substitution principle. It's the one I had a hard time understanding, because this is what I first read about the Liskov. The math part, like the mathematical part. I mean, I am a math graduate, so I could, in theory, I could understand what it means, but how it plays out in the code base, I don't really know. So, in short, it's just any child class should be able to replace its parent. Like wherever the parent class is used, you should be able to just replace it with the child, and it should still work without any side effects or unexpected consequences. Like I have two examples here actually. Here's a rectangle that sets height and width. Basic. Simple class. I mean, you all get rectangles. But say the square. If you don't look at the code, the square is a rectangle, right? Like it's easy. It's easy for us to do this in when we don't code it yet, and we just think about it in concept, like a square is a rectangle. But say if you make it a child class of rectangle and set height, implement set height and width such that whatever you set height or width, it would update the other. So say you have a code base that uses rectangle and just say, for example, sets height, it doesn't expect that the width would automatically change. So that's one example. Another would be, any questions about this example? All right. here, this is an unfinished example actually. Just have a bird. It can do stuff. It can peck. It can hop. It can fly. But say, for example, you add. You think about something else that doesn't fly, like a penguin. So, would you want to say? I don't fly. So say if you have a game like that uses a bird and expects it to fly, now you can't use a penguin. You can't plug in a penguin into the bird class because it can't fly. Same with an ostrich. It can't fly also. Maybe it could run. It can't hop. It also can't hop. Yeah. It hasn't. So, any ideas on how to implement an ostrich-like object? And a penguin like without having to use inheritance. So I'm gonna do this on the fly. I have an idea of how to do it, but let's see. Okay. Maybe an ostrich is a bird. That has, maybe we could decorate it. You could just add run here. Right. But it doesn't, does it hop or fly? We need to modify the bird class so that it doesn't have a hop or a fly. Like we could just you know what? I'll just implement it in the penguin class. You get the point here. You just add the function via decorating it. For the penguin, what could you do? You could say that all birds by default don't fly. They don't fly by default. Maybe in an initializer you could say initialize, you could add wings to it. And then in a penguin would be a bird that has no wings. Right? Like a penguin would be a bird. It's different, just no wings. Or maybe you could even put something like a null wing new object that just doesn't give you the ability to fly. So that's how you could implement it. Any questions? Okay, I'll proceed. For the fourth one, interface segregation principle, it's not really a problem in Ruby. but we can cover it anyway. Basically, it says no client should be forced to depend on methods that it does not use. And I'll just go straight ahead with an example in a SWIP. So you have a test that initializes with the test questions, and it has functions answer question and grade question. You don't need to really read into the implementation. You just have, say for example, you have a class user that can take a test. Yes, it will work if you put a test into it, but now in Swift, it requires you to actually have a test, something that is a test, that is of a test class. In Ruby, how this would play out is that in the gear class, you could just put anything that responds to anything that it responds to whatever it needs. So in this example, you could say there's a Ruby class user that takes a test that responds to take test, and you just plug in anything that responds to answer question. So it's not really a problem in Ruby. But you could implement something like that in Swift, but you have to write it. Like, there's no doc typing. So you would have to define a protocol that should have an answer question, and you would have test implement that protocol. So that's, so any questions clear so far? Any thumbs up? Just a response? Because I don't know if you are asked. There, okay. So the last one would be dependency inversion principle. So big picture abstraction, just abstraction should not depend on details. Details should not depend on abstractions. What could be an example of this? Maybe business logic should not depend on the something that easily changes, like data or coming from database, from an API, from even a flat file, a YAML file. In this example, we just have some usage file parser that takes in a client and a parser, and basically in this example, you could plug in an XML parser or a CSV parser, and what dependency inversion principle is trying to make you achieve is that in this case, usage file parser wouldn't have to depend on how the data is collected, so that it could use the data, whether it comes from an XML or a CSV. So that's dependency inversion. I think the gear example also covers this as well, although that is a very simplistic example. Questions? Some exercises. Actually, what helped me gain a bit of what helped me is this book, the Puder book. Has anybody read it? Practical Object Oriented Design. Design in Ruby. Maybe now you know. We stand the Mets. It's also called the Puder book, like informally. It kind of gives you a few ways, practical ways to apply not just solid but just design in any given code base. Like, but really, another thing that helped me, because this one I've read this a couple of times, but it didn't stick to me, because at the time I was maybe I had a less than a year's experience, and this I just read it like in one weekend, and of course anything without practice doesn't stick. So what I sometimes do is just maybe open a well-known Rails project or Ruby project, like GitLab or Discourse. Just get one class and then upload it to speedcoder.net, because I also practice sometimes touch typing with code, because it's touch typing, just a side note, touch typing in with sentences is easy, but what I found hard when I started applying the touch typing into code is that oftentimes I would press some buttons with more frequently than others, like the usual suspects would be the ones in the right side of the keyboard, the symbols of up, so you have to press shift often. So just a side note. Also, so going back to practice, there's this one exercise called Gilded Rose Kata. Has anybody heard of it? It's basically all I can say is just it's that it's a deeply nested code that you have to refactor. Some versions of it have tests, some of it don't. So this is probably an exercise that you can do in a weekend, maybe, and then maybe share with someone who has done the exercise as well. I haven't. You can just Google it. Actually, there's a GitHub repo, although I don't remember the name, that has this Gilded Rose Kata implemented in a variety of languages, not just Ruby. So just take that up, and then also just plugging in another book that I like, Confident Ruby by Abdigrim. It's just something he has a certain style of writing code, basically. So whether that goes into design or not, I'm not sure, but it's nice. It's a nice book. So that's it. Summary, maybe I don't need to give that summary. Just any questions? Violent reactions, thumbs up. All right, thank you.